walk anyway. So good evening, everyone. So I won't walk up there, it creates too much noise, and I walk anyway. So this is a presentation I created last year. I've given it approximately 3 or 4 times now. It continues to morph and evolve. I will promise you that this will be a game changer for you tonight. And more importantly, for me to give a successful presentation, it needs to be actionable. Bless you. So you will find that there is actionable items for you to do in this presentation tonight. Just so you know, with digital disruption, we actually did, it was a two-part. The first part was a roundtable of sorts where we had some industry leaders came in and talked, and I followed up with this concept of a career curriculum. So when we talk about disruption really isn't a new thing. We've all experienced it in some way, shape, or form. And while this is not necessarily in a chronological listing, in a sense, we could talk to it in that way. It was the old, you know, layoffs and job termination. Those were things that we could consider disruptive. Company mergers and bankruptcy. One company typically wins, the other company typically loses. We've seen that. Government and activity and regulation. If you don't think that doesn't have an impact on the job market, I can tell you that I had an internship at Exxon when I went to college, and the only reason I'm not working for Exxon today is because Ronald Reagan canceled the 10% synthetic oil subsidy, and Exxon had a 10% across the board layoff. Automation. Automation was always considered to be a job killer. Then we had this thing called outsourcing. And outsourcing, what did outsourcing do, right? It suddenly made this a worldwide phenomenon. Internet shopping and the competition with brick and mortar. Ask Borders in Circuit City how well that worked out for them. We had the financial collapse. Basically, we had way too many people in the financial sector, and when it all crashed and burned, we saw the result of that. There's the impact of the millennials and the disruption that they encounter, or they can bring to an organization. And now we've got this thing that you may have heard from time to time, disruptive technologies. Anyone know what this is? I love this. This was on social media. This is great. No longer in distance, but anyone know what this is? This is great. Well, a paper, that's good. Believe it or not, this was making the rounds on social media last year. This was from the 1991 advertisement from Radio Shack, front page. And what's so great about this particular advertisement is that there's approximately 15 technologies on here. There's a weather stereo, there's a clock radio, there's earphones, there's a calculator, there's a mobile phone, CD player, answering machine, compact, I mean, all this great stuff, right? Replaced by the iPhone. Now, while this is kind of nice and, you know, all this wonderful stuff, I want you to think about the following. First, put yourself in the role of the company president or the company owner. And let's use the answering machine. Remember the old cassette tapes that went in the answering machine? Let's really make this good. And you were project manager in the tape division. 1991, life's great, right? You're selling these things, everything's wonderful. Right? And then all of a sudden, demand starts going down because it went digital first. It just didn't go to the phone. It went digital, and then it went to the phone. And suddenly, if you got laid off around whatever it was, 2007, I think, when the iPhone was announced, first, what happened to your skill set over here? If you knew about tape, what did you do with that, right? You got a problem. Additionally, if you were the owner of the company, what were you doing? Were you investing in plant and property and new products? Probably not. If you were doing it, you might have been looking at digital or other technologies that weren't tape. The point being that while you could be dumb, fat, and happy with these today, you don't necessarily know what tomorrow brings. This is the money slide. Does everyone know what's on? Any of these ring familiar? By any chance? Starting in the upper right-hand corner, cloud computing. What a disruptive game changer this one is, right? Why? You no longer need big data centers. Companies no longer need to build them out. Companies no longer have to lay out the money. They can basically go to a pay-as-you-go model. Huge disruptor. We know what Bitcoin is. These are called digital currencies, and this is a currency that's not based on anything. It's purely digital. But this whole concept of digital currencies, what does that mean? What does your organization need to do to participate in this? Is it risky? Is it regulated? Who knows? 3D printers. 3D printers are going to change manufacturing if they haven't already, and it's amazing what they're able to do here. In fact, Amazon wants to be able to print product locally and deliver it same day. Self-driving car. Think about the impact of the self-driving car. Your taxi driver, you may have a problem, but if you own a restaurant, you may really be happy because now people can drink and drive home and not have to worry about it. I'm sure you've heard of big data. Conceptually, we have tons of data that are out there that were never processed. It was too expensive. We now have very cheap ways of processing that data. Cognitive computing. About 6 years ago, IBM was on the Jeopardy show with Computer Watson, and they beat the humans. During that show, my mind was spinning because I knew the next two spaces that they were going to go with this, which would be what? Which one? No. What does a lot of paper? Legal and medical. And sure enough, guess what spaces that they're in? Wearables. Apple finally came out with the watch. All different types of personal devices and sensors. Virtual reality will change gaming, will change education, because you will immerse people in real life situations instead of on paper. This is actually the easiest one. Social, it's been around the longest, at least you're comfortable with it, but what's the impact? Robotics, if you want to see strange, crazy stuff, look at what Google and Honda's been doing in this particular space. Amazing stuff. Drones, think if you're a real estate agent. You can now start taking pictures from above. You can actually take pictures within a house and do a flyby within the house. Amazing stuff. Crowdsourcing, the ability to use the power of the internet for yourself. There's a company called Kaggle that actually sponsors contests where people go out and they participate. And in this sense, it's their way of putting their resume out. Kickstarter and all those funding type things. The barrier of entry of funding has changed. So this is another disruptive technology. Analytics, which goes with big data, but now it's trying to get meaning out of that data. And I guarantee you, within about a 5-year period, most jobs will be impacted in some way, shape, or form as something as simple as analytics. How many of you use LinkedIn? I hope everybody's hands go up, right? You know that recommended people you may know in the upper right-hand corner? They figure it out at night. They're using analytics just to derive that information. And finally, my personal favorite, the Internet of Things, which in its simplest form is home automation, is the ability to have sensors and technologies at your command. So how many of you have heard of Amazon's Alexa or the Echo? Right? So that, well, I have one at home. Now my wife, who is not technology friendly, I have her turning on the hall lights on and off, because the hall lights are connected to the internet as well. And she says, Alexa, turn the hall lights on, Alexa, turn the hall lights off, and it works. How many of you have seen these or heard of these in some way, shape, or form? Right? Here's the real question. What are you doing about it? Ah, why we're here. So, if you look this up, 2012, there was a TED Talk. And the TED Talk was about education. But during that education, this gentleman made this prediction that basically turned the world on its ear. And it was that 2 billion jobs were going to disappear by 2030. That's pretty scary. The theme behind the presentation wasn't so much that the jobs were going to go away, in so much that they were going to be replaced. And if you, in this follow-up article, he gives these 5 examples. And you can see the power industry, driverless cars, education, 3D printers, and bots, robotics. And what he did was he almost did a pro and a con, in a sense, that he says, in this particular space, here is what the disruptive technology is, here are the jobs that will be impacted, and here are the jobs that will be created. How many of you have even done that basic work on a disruptive technology. So one of the things that's going to be a to-do item for everybody here in the room. To me, this is another money slide. We're all, as I like to call it, victims of this. Go back to your school days. What were you taught? That if you go to school and you get an education and good grades and you get your degree and you get a job, that you're going to live happily ever after. Was this not the message? Work harder. Go do that. Right? You need an education. These were the mantras. Now, something else I want you to think about. At your job, whatever any job, doesn't really matter. Did your job encourage disruption? Hell no. The first problem is what suffered from what I call attaboys. Everyone know what an attaboy is? You pat someone on the back and you go, attaboy, right? Think about a COBOL programmer. All these new languages were coming out in all these directions, and the COBOL programmers kind of the tap on the back, attaboy, attaboy, attaboy. And what happened when COBOL was no longer in vogue? Yep. The other problem in most corporations and most companies, and I can understand this, is keep the lights on, right? They don't necessarily want change because they don't like change, because change is disruption. Disruption could impact something. So these drivers and these drivers keep you what? Static. Dumb, fat, and happy, whatever you like to call it. This is the inertia. This is what you got to get past. Because guess what? If you've been doing this for 30 years, how easy is change? I love change. Things could change every minute of every day. I'd be happy. Be ecstatic. I love it. Most people, however, do not like change. So these make it even harder when the change hits. This is not set it and forget it anymore. It just isn't. Another problem that comes up when you are disrupted is in the absence of a plan. And I can go on side journeys as to why I have problems with many things in the world nowadays, because we refuse to understand the root cause of a problem and we think we can feel good and act. But with the idea that change is terrifying and there are layoffs at your company, one reaction, and I've heard this in other networking groups, I'm going to work harder. Is that not a reaction? I'm going to work harder. Because if I put my head down, I won't be next. Wrong. Not going to work. You might even go so far as to go out and get a certification. Well, that's not going to work either for the same reason. What's the root cause of the problem? You can't fix a problem if you don't know what's wrong. And in my world, what I see, most people are reactive rather than proactive, which is this last bullet. The next challenge is a perception that there is no time. There's no time to do this because fill in the blank. Spouse, kids, hobby, commute, too much work, pick one, right? It's easy to fill this up and say, I have no time. So the first thing I would like to do with you is introduce this concept of a career horizon. And to give you an appreciation of what I think a career horizon is, and by the way, I don't tell you to do anything I don't do myself. I've done this. Does everyone know what an investment horizon is? Good. An investment horizon, you should know. So I'm going to use two prototypical people through this. An individual that's 20 years old and an individual that's 50 years old, just to make the math work. And we're going to use 65 as our age of retirement. So if you're 20 years old, you have a 45-year window. If you're 50, you have a 15-year window. If you know anything about investing, when you're younger, you can afford what? More risk. Why? You have a longer investment horizon. And if you're 50 years old, you have a shorter investment horizon, right? Okay. Your career is no different. When you were 20 years old, and go back to when each of you were 20, how different was the world then? Very. Well, guess what? When I give this pitch, when I gave this pitch in another, I've used this idea in another presentation, you pick the time frame. I used 5 years because it makes sense. So if you're 20 years old, and you have a 45-year window until you retire, at a minimum, you're going to have to learn 9 new things in your career. If you're 50 years old, retiring at 65, in theory, you might learn 3 new things. Now, that may or may not be true, only because you might be able to ride one of those out a little longer. And I could give you examples about COBOL programmers during the year 2000 and what happened in everything before 1995 and everything that happened after 1995. You really have to think this particular one through, but you see the idea. You got to plan out and say, okay, if I have 15 years left, what do I have to do to make sure that I'm relevant? I am of the belief personally, and you can disagree with me if you'd like, we do have a skills problem. And we have a skills problem for a lot of reasons, some of which was on that earlier slide. With all of those new technologies that are out, there's just too much to know. The next thing I'd like to review is we'll know about compounding, right? Does compounding happen overnight? As much as we would like it to, it doesn't happen overnight. And there's something to be said of periodically investing money that regardless of the rate of return, the money that you get from the investments is more than what you put in. Interest earning interest, right? Great concept. Well, getting back to the concept of time, what I would like for you to think about is compound your time. And this is kind of having some fun, but I want to just play with you guys to think you do have time. So, in order to demonstrate this, let's take a 3-credit class. And these are approximate numbers, just, you know, not to write these down. But typically, a 1-credit class meets approximately 15 weeks or 14 weeks, whatever it is, 15 minutes a week. We're dealing with approximately 750 minutes worth of class time for 1 credit. So if we do the math and we multiply it by 3, we get to that wonderful 2,250 minutes, which is a whopping 37 and a half hours. If you dedicated just 6 minutes a day, every day, for an entire year, you basically have accomplished a 3-minute class. And truth be told, if you increase this just by a little bit, 10 minutes, you're up to 5 credits, believe it or not. Now, I would argue you might want to do a half an hour to an hour, but think about this now in terms of what you can learn this year, next year, and the year after that, just 3 years. Where are you going to be? Where would you be in 3 years? Just picking up something new. 15 credits later, where would you be? Would you be farther ahead than you are today? Right? Is this a lot of time? It's not a lot of time. This is the new normal. It's not slowing down. It's not going to stop. It's going to get worse. And it's going to get worse because the entry requirements are changing. The entry requirements are not becoming any less. I can tell you a story of an individual that was in the database space. And in that particular space, the person had said to me that they had been out of work for a period of time. And I just started a conversation. I said, let me help you out. Like, you know, what do you do? And because they were in data, I said, so what are you doing in the big data space? And the person looked at me and said, what's big data? I kid you not. So, you got to keep your skills current. If you don't, it's a decision. Understand that decision. So again, if you don't want to keep your skills current at age 64, that might not be a problem if you're retiring at 65. But if you don't keep your skills current at 59, I would suggest it's a problem. I have a video on my YouTube channel. I'll give you the link later. I have this other video I did. I call You the Product. But it really gets you thinking about yourself in terms of how do you market yourself, how do you package yourself. And there's overlap with this particular presentation. It's free. It's out on my channel. I encourage you to look at it. Skills have a marketable lifespan. If you don't think of it this way, start thinking of it this way. How many COBOL programmers? What's the demand for COBOL programmers? What's the demand for punch card operators?
Zero.
And I can tell you I did my senior project on punch cards. I embrace this line. This describes me. I like change. That's my differentiator. Also helps I have a last name I can do something with. But keeping pace with this stuff, you're doing something that your competition is not doing. So here's a quick example. How many of you do a blog? Is anyone blogging? Anyone blogging here? Two people. Let me ask you a question. There's 10 of you in a room. I'm going to interview all 10. And for this example, you're all equally qualified, the same background, the same education, the same stunning personality. You're all great. If you're all equal, you have a 1 in 10 chance of getting the job. Right? You're all equal. What's the differentiator? If I went on an interview, one of the very first things I would make sure I got into that conversation instantly is that I have my own YouTube channel. And the very first thing that the interviewer typically says is what? You have a YouTube channel? What is it about? I've suddenly taken myself out of all the rote and memorized answers, and I just put myself over here. Doesn't guarantee I'll get hired, but I sure do now have name recognition. I know how to build an audience. I know what the dynamics of building an audience are. I know what the dynamics are of presenting. I know what the dynamics are of creating a 3-minute video. May not get me that job. I just now have planted the seeds I could potentially work my way in. Why don't you have a blog? Differentiation is the key, and it gets back to this, you the product. Here's another one. I was talking to a group before about this. Here's another idea. Once upon a time, this concept of being the SME was the thing. You got really, everyone knows that, right, subject matter expert. You became the SME. The problem is there's too much to know. And instead of knowing the thing, know how the things work together. You know what a jump that is? That's a huge jump. Because by and large, the attaboys were for this. This is a lot different. Yes? Well, this is the world according to me, but yes. I think your flexibility, because go back to that earlier chart. There's too many things to know. And what happens is, you know, there's a reason why your hand has 5 fingers on it. Right? If you unfortunately lose a finger, your hand still works, right? That's the idea behind this. Even if you can't get good enough knowledge, what I would suggest that you do is you have to stay current with the terminology. If nothing else. Because I can get you in a room and I can start talking to you and I will instantly know if you are old or not. And that has nothing to do with physical age. I will know if you are technology obsoleted or not because the verbiage has changed. Something simple. How many people know what a hashtag is? Like really know what a hashtag is that can talk to what a hashtag is? That's a problem. That's just a small sampling. Now obviously you can't know everything. But a hashtag, if you're talking to a millennial, rest assured they know what a hashtag is and they know what the value proposition of it is. And just so everyone knows what it is though, right? A hashtag, high level. All right, real quick. Within a tweet, if we were using Twitter, a little pound sign. And a little pound sign I can use for a lot of things. I can use for emphasis, for sarcasm. By and large, a hashtag is an index. But what can I do with that index? Oh, I can do a great many things. If I wanted to get identified by a company, I would use hashtag and the ticker symbol of that company. That would be one thing. If I were running a big data operation at work and I were running analytics, you think hashtags have meaning to me? Absolutely, because I might be able to take those hashtags and relate it off to something else. But what was I just able to do in that very short example? I took the terminology and did what? Made it real. I made it real. That's the trick to this. You don't have to know it down to this level of being the SME, but you need to at least be conversant to see. So how many of you know how an engine works? Handful, right? It's got cylinders and spark plugs and you need feeler gauges. But when you're going at 85 miles an hour down the road, you don't need to know how the engine works. Just as good. We'll get to that, but yeah, that's start. That's gonna get, you're stealing the thunder off one of my slides. That's okay. This is great. I don't normally put a lot of text in my presentation. Read this. 2015, Uber owns no vehicles. Facebook, no crates, no content. Alibaba, no inventory. Airbnb, no real estate. This is the new normal. Did I scare you all yet? Is this good? Okay, so how do we fix this? Well, as I was thinking about how to make this tangible, we were all introduced to something once upon a long time ago. Some of it was covertly, but go back to your early days of grade school, from kindergarten through 12th grade, and then we can add college onto it as well. But there were things that you learned in every single year of school that were additive. You learned basic math turned into geometry, geometry turned into algebra, algebra turned into calculus. And of course, you killed your teacher at the end of that. But here, there was a building block, prerequisites, and the school did the work for you. When you got to college, they started to separate that. They still provided the structure. They still told you what you needed. It was up to you to figure out all of that work. So what I'm telling you initially is start thinking about doing what we're doing in the form of a curriculum. Sometime you're going to find people that will give you a curriculum. Sometime you need to create the curriculum. And the reason is I don't know where you are on the spectrum. If you know nothing or you know everything, there's no one size fits all, right? You're going to have to figure out what is important to you. Great movie, by the way. So think about how you create it and picked your major, in a sense. The first thing you did as a kid was you went through all these assessment tests, right? You would go through these things. Are you college material? Aren't you college material? You know, Briggs-Meyer, all that other stuff, right? But there was this assessment of, what the heck do I want to do? And it becomes even more important later, and we'll get to this, as to how do you do a self-assessment? You then did some research. That research could have been a whole bunch of stuff. You could have joined something and experimented with it. You could have spent some time reading about it or studying it, but you did some research. You had some type of a guidance counselor. We can go back to network as an example, but you used your parents. You used some counselors. You finally took the classes once you had all of this figured out, and then you magically got a diploma when it was all done. So what does that mean? Your assessment strategy. This is a tough one. This is a you thing. I like to preface this one with, after a couple glasses of wine, this is a good example. I would tell you I've been through this. I went through this at a time where my career diverted a little bit and I lost track of it. This really isn't, I want to be something. I like to use the vernacular, what floats your boat? I don't know, but what floats it? Now, I realize in this that you may have a number of personal challenges. A family member could be sick. Children, finances, I don't know what it is. But during this assessment, you gotta figure all of this out and get it on a piece of paper. You don't have to share with anybody, but it's really being honest with yourself. I'm gonna show you why in a second this is important. The frequency of how often you need to do this is going to vary. I would suggest if you're starting out, you need to do it more frequently until you start getting this as common. And this is this part, this assessment's gonna take time. In a sense, you almost wanna get to the point of, and I can tell you, in my life there was a moment where when I did this, I wrote something down. I do not want to be a blah. It was like a 50-pound stone was just lifted off of my back because I finally put it down on paper. I don't want to be this. And guess what my career was taking me to? Exactly that. When you see a technology that you might, and we get back to this assessment thing, I'm going to suggest that you ask 6 watts. Six. They're all kind of, I mean, you have to memorize the 6 watts. But the first one is, what is the technology? That's the first one. What is it? The second one would be, what does it do? What does it do? The third one, what is a business going to find interesting about this? The fourth, what jobs is it going to impact? The next one would be, what jobs is it going to create? And the last what are you doing about it? When I look at these technologies, my brain goes through it in seconds. And it's why I know where I would dedicate my time versus where I wouldn't, but that's for me. This is part of the assessment process, but this one's even better. I'm going to give you 3 examples. You don't have to nod. You don't have to smile. Hopefully, I'll touch a button with at least one of you. The first example, Bill Smith. Bill Smith is vice president of the punch card division of Acme Inc. Bill Smith is 55 years old and knows everything there is to know about punch cards, from the best paper to use to how often to clean the machines. He's got it nailed. And Monday morning, he's going to get laid off. And Bob is thinking, because I'm a vice president, I'm going to get hired in a short period of time. And damn it, I'm going to find another punch card job. And I forgot to mention, and Bob is making a salary of $150,000 a year. What's the problem? This is called fantasy land, that first one. This is a complete divorce from what's going on or the reality of where your skill sets align. So that's problem number one. Do your skill sets align with the marketplace? Number two. Bill Smith is a programmer. Bill's a pretty good programmer. Again, I'll just use 150, it's just a number. Let's say Bill's making $150,000 a year. Bill has one minor problem. And Bill's problem is although he's making $150,000 a year, Bill spends $200,000 a year. So now Bill gets laid off on Monday. I know someone like this, by the way. Bill gets laid off on Monday, and what's Bill looking for in his next job? Oh, no, worse. What's Bill looking for? Well, he's looking for 2 or more. Why? That's what he's used to spending, right? That's what I'm spending, right? But what's the market going to tell him? Yeah, the market's going to be, this is one group of people that says, I can't find work. This is another problem. The third and last problem, get back to Bill Smith. Bill's making $150,000 a year. Bill's a project manager. And you know what Bill can't stand? Being a project manager. He hates his job, truly despises his job. But he's built his life around making $150,000 a year, so he grins and bears it. He goes to work. Monday, Bill gets laid off. Bill's going to try and find another project management job. Do you think Bill's going to find another project management job? Why not? This is really subtle. Let's say the skills are okay. There's the word I'm looking for. In the middle of that interview, someone's going to look at him and go, oh my God. This guy's going to sap the energy out of our company within 2 hours of being here. There would be absolutely no passion. He would not be able to display 1 ounce of passion during that interview. So during that assessment, I need you to get down to this level. Really get down to this level. And again, you can make up other ones. This was just to get you thinking. Research. I will admit I have a sickness. This is my sickness. I'm a news junkie. I'm a research junkie. I like to know what's going on. I don't like to have those moments of I don't know. It's a sickness. But what I want you to think about here is that in order for you to make a decision and in order for you to keep abreast of what's going on in the marketplace, you really have to figure out what sources of data are out there that you can consume, and more importantly, in the format you like to have them in. Now, for me, I don't care. I could get it in Twitter, I could get it in a book, it doesn't matter. Some people may want it in hard copy. Some people may want a physical, go do this, I don't know. But there's a number of technologies that are out there that can help you with this. The trick, especially if you're new to this, you've got to figure out a way to do it slowly, because it will be like opening the fire hydrant and having the water squirt straight at you. You can get overwhelmed in seconds. I would just tell you, this gets back to this whole luck favors the prepared, and you've got to think about yourself. If you take nothing else away from this deck, how are you differentiating yourself? This at least is going to tell you what's coming and the language. Now, where can you start? We could be here probably for 2 hours talking on this one. But the first one, and I can get you these links. The first one is you might want to look at what's going on in the startup space. This is most definitely going to tell you what's potentially coming in the next 3 to 7 years. Potentially. So you can start looking on, and this would happen to be a Forbes one, but there's a number around startups. The next one is when you see the top entrepreneurs. What are they doing? Now, they could be a link to these startups, but maybe they're not. The third one, what are the venture capitalists doing? What are they working on? And my other favorite is, you know, what the heck's the government doing? And the government, trust me, there's a lot of things that they can do, but they also give at least some job projections that they see as well. So one source of research could be this. This could be helping you say, am I a startup person? Are these the type of jobs or the types of technologies or approaches or services that I like? Maybe they're not. But at some point in time, they're going to make it into a large company as well. To show you the wide range of stuff that's out there, and I found this one by complete accident, by the way. But if you go to radar.urban.us, what it does is it looks at technologies focused on urban and suburban environments. So you, and these are all the different, again, there was different ways to slice and dice this information. But this just goes to show you the wide range of possibilities or what you should be looking for in your research that you might find valuable to you. Another one, you can go to the trade rags, as it were. This one was from, I think, CNET, if I'm not mistaken. But this particular one, just to show you, get back to virtual, the fact that it's going to hit $150 billion in a potential time frame, which gets back to your what? Career horizon, right? So now, something like this, you could say to yourself, virtual reality excites me. The next thing you can do is you can start thinking about the money that's being spent. You can think about the potential timelines. You're going to pick up the companies that are playing, which are Facebook and Google and Microsoft. And this starts telling you, do I want to network with these companies? Do I want to find someone on LinkedIn that I can find out what types of classes or what types of education might be helpful? So this one article could give you a ton of actionable information or actionable items just based on if it matched something you wanted to do and a time frame and direction of what the other companies are doing. How many of you use Google Alerts? This is fantastic. This is the cheapest of cheap, by the way. All you have to do with Google Alerts is you just basically, in this particular one, I said, anything that you get that's technology and trends, bring it back to me. Now, needless to say, this was overwhelming at some point, right? But what it's doing is it's giving me a daily update. And what it's doing is, here's all the articles. I didn't have to do the Google search. Google did it for me. So Google Alerts, one of the beauties of this are you're going to learn the keywords to search for based on the thing that you're looking for. Best part of all, it's free. There's also something that's called paper.li, P-A-P-E-R.li. You can actually have your paper.li create your own paper. You can tell it all the things that you want to see in that, and it delivers it daily into your mailbox. Paper.li. L-I. It's good so far? So you've heard of a SWOT analysis, right? Well, one of the tools I would suggest that are very worthwhile in this particular space is a SWOT analysis on yourself. So when you see these new technologies, when you see these disruptive things, you might start asking yourself, well, wait a minute. And you can do this a number of different ways. There's no right or wrong way, by the way. One way to look at it is identify off to the side all of the pieces of your research that says, in order for me to play with this technology or this disruptive thing, I found out it probably needs this, whatever this is. You can then take, remember I said to do your own personal assessment? Start taking your personal assessment and map it against that list. Where are the strengths? Where are the weaknesses? The example I like to use here, and one of the things I talk about in terms of getting, it's on the next one, about, I'll say for about being a mentor, but it's about being a doctor. It's kind of fun. So strengths and weaknesses, and then you can look at the technology and say, what are the opportunities and what are the threats? So now, if your strengths line up to the opportunities, or you see the opportunities, you got a home run here, right? So you can kind of use this as just a general tool to say, how do I see if this is right for me? The guidance counselor. You need your own network. I don't care if that's a mentor, I don't care if that's your own personal board of directors, I don't really come in here, you know, ask me, whatever. But you really want someone that's gonna look at you and say, are you nuts? Here's my example. Let's say that I don't like blood and I hate giving needles, but I really wanna become a doctor. You need someone to look at you and say, George, we gotta have a conversation because you're going over here and I know a little bit about you, the two don't meet, right? So all this particular slide says, it's okay to talk to people and it's okay to find out. This is how you learn about the other companies anyway. This is why you need to stretch. This is why you need to network. Now from a course catalog strategy, at this point in time, once you've figured out what it is that you'd be interested in, and you think that it aligns with who you are, you really need to start saying to yourself, all right, how the hell do I get there? Now, again, it could be simple tasks, it could be major tasks, but you have to start figuring out what might this look like. Now, fortunately, because we have this new thing called the internet, there's a lot of help that exists out there today. So, the first one, and these are examples just as visuals to help you think about where these opportunities may exist. First, there's these things of organization and best practices sites. So this particular one was cloudbestpractices.net. And basically, if you went there, you'll find that there's companies such as Rackspace and Robotics Courseware was a different one. That these actually laid out the different types of skills or classes that you need. So in a sense, they built part of that curriculum for you. There really wasn't much work you had to do. In this particular meetup, this was an IBM Watson in cognitive computing. They talked about it, but I would go here to start meeting the people involved in that space to find out what skills or what opportunities are to learn these particular technologies. One site, if you're into big data or analytics interests you, Kaggle is an amazing place. They actually run contests where teams get together and compete against each other for prizes. Kaggle is a fantastic opportunity to build your network and an example of how you would go about interacting with people to learn a space. For those that haven't heard about MIT OpenCourseWare, there's a whole plethora of free education out on the internet. There's some cheap ones. Udemy happens to be another one. And when we talk about a curriculum, one of the other things to think about as well are electives, right? You didn't always take majors, you took electives. One of the things I would suggest as one of your electives, on YouTube, they have things that are just based on interviewing. Why not do one of those a week or one of those a day, just so you keep the answers fresh in your head as to how you approach them? This one was from Coursera. If you notice, this was a course that they provided for the Data Scientist's Toolbox. And look what they had here. What does that look like? What does that look like? Like a curriculum. First we start with programming, then data, then analysis, then research. They actually started providing this for you. So now, you could start chipping off each one of these. And again, I'm just giving you ideas as to there is help out there to create this on your own. This was just another one from, I forget who this was from, I think this was Rackspace. But again, you can get a certification program, and at the bottom, they start listing out all of the courses that you would need to take. So there's no, it's out there. It's just a matter of what interests you and what resources you find. The last part to all of this, and probably the trickiest, there isn't necessarily a diploma once you finish, right? And your mileage may vary on this. In this day and age, what I would suggest to you, if you're going to do all of this work, you got to do this. You've got to create a something. Much like if you went to buy a car, and they have all the glossy information, and they've got a website. You are a product. And your business card, as an example, could be a piece of marketing information, but what I would suggest to you is you need more. To me, these are all differentiators. A blog in of itself, and if you watch my You the Product, I talk about why blogs are hard. Basically, you have to understand what a story is. But you have to figure out what you can do here in the absence of having that diploma. Because when you get to that interview and someone asks you a question, you want to get them out into a space where you say, hey, great question, I've tackled this, and here are some of the things I can show you about how I've tackled it. How frequently do you need to do this? More is better. More is better. That's the best way for me to say it. Maybe if you can get a certification helps. It's additive. But you have to get yourself out there. Think of yourself as a consultant. Why would I hire you? Well, if you can show me that you've tackled some of these things, you know, a video. Oh my God. I was doing video on my own at home. Thank goodness I'm a technology person, but what I learned just from doing a video, and even within 3 minutes, oh, I can have a conversation now for 2 hours. It's a great conversation, but it breaks the ice. If you want a challenge, figure out how to get a blog and get to 1,000 users, 1,000 followers. You want to talk about something on your next interview? You don't think that's going to impress someone if you can get to 1,000 on a blog? Might not impress them, but you now have what? You've differentiated yourself, bare minimum. And then watch my video. So aligning the concepts. I wish I were more graphically inclined, but the general idea at the bottom, put your map on the bottom, you know, zero to whatever. On top of that, you got to think about the frequency of your research, because your research is then going to drive. Well, actually, your research and your assessments are going to start driving your classes and when you need to do these. And then you pick the topics you're interested in, and then you start layering your education on top of it. So if nothing else, this is giving you a plan of attack that if you wanted to go into your boss and worry about your yearly, developmental plan, you can actually use pieces of this to generate your own development plan. So here's my bringing it all together example. I can tell you a really silly joke, too, about Hugh the blacksmith. But we got this blacksmith, and his name is Hugh. And Hugh's really good. Hugh can horseshoe or shoe 1,000 horses in a day. Hugh is great. Big burly guy. And all of a sudden, he hears about this thing called the car. And he's like, yeah, who the hell cares about that? You know, they're big, they're clunky, they're noisy, there's no roads, they're not comfortable. You know, there's no gas stations around. And about 6 months later, Hugh's now down to 500 horses a day because the demand starts impacting. And now all of a sudden the horses get down to about 250 a day, and Hugh's realizing that he may need to change his career. So he goes out there and he starts learning some stuff about a car. And what does he find out about it? Lots of metal. There's no horse, right? There's no horse. He sees that it's clearly a threat to what he's doing. He can visually see it, but it's based on metal. And there's many types of metal. There's finished metal, there's the raw metal of the engine, there's a lot of different places metal's used in the car. So for Hugh, in this particular instance, his skill of working with horses may be obsoleted, but the fact that he knows metal fits and aligns at least with the strength and opportunity of the car. So that was the point of this cutesy little thing. So, quick survey. Did you find this useful? Was it worth your time? Was it entertaining? Good. I did my job. So, how can you keep pace with me? Many ways. My YouTube channel, keeppace, youtube.com, keeppace. I would really tell you, watch you, the product. There's another one I have up there. It's how do you use Twitter to find a job? If you go to a site called Storify.com, keeppace, I actually give you clickable links where I run the Twitter search for you. So I actually have all the embedded URLs. So you can actually not only look at the presentation, but you can see some of the, I had a handout when I gave the presentation, so obviously I can't give a handout online. Bless you. And then my Facebook page, and I'm not tweeting yet, but I'm getting close. And I think that's it. Questions?